Please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
The best investment is an investment in knowledge, and knowledge it is that we are here to help you with. Hello and welcome, I'm Radhika Sinha and you're watching NSC FinWiz Season 5 powered by CNBC TV 18. And today we are here at Dr. Reddy's Laboratories at their Vizag campus to discuss the power of compounding and the benefits of starting early.
In less than 35 years of its existence, Dr. Reddy's has become among the most trusted names in the pharma industry. The brand has been consistent in serving the needs of millions of patients by providing quality and affordable medicines. NSC FinWiz, with its theme Dream On, visited Dr. Reddy's laboratories in Visakhapatnam to demystify just that.
I feel in a professional, personal, educational or financial way altogether, anywhere finance becomes the heart of life, so financial literacy is must.
Importance of investment is very important for the team, for the employees, because if they understood, they start at this age, they can really enjoy the magic of compound interest, you know, at that time when they get retired or at the fag end of their life.
Being a woman, I would like to ask one question. These days, people are very crazy about investment. So I want to know what would be the right investment. As a woman, I feel like I should invest in gold. What I feel is whatever amount I have savings, I want to invest in gold. But my husband says we can invest in land, we can invest in property. So I want to know what would be the correct way of investment.
The only question I'm looking forward to ask to the expert is what are the good tools and the investment plans that I should invest in so that I can afford a big house in the long term run, in let's say in a span of 10 to 20 years. So this is what I'll ask, and I look forward to ask to the experts today.
Hello and welcome. You're watching NSC FinWiz Season 5 powered by CNBC TV 18. Today we are here at Dr. Reddy's Laboratories at their Vizag campus with our set of financial experts. Joining us here, Gajendra Kothari and Harsh Roongta. Welcome to the show, gentlemen. Okay, so let me start with you, Gajendra. So a lot of us talk about power of compounding, but to the smart investors here, young investors here, right, what advice would you give to them? What is power of compounding?
See, we all have studied this formula called compound interest in our mathematics subject when we were in standard 7th and 8th. A simple formula called compounding interest, which is what is the final amount you get, is the principal you invest, the rate of return you multiply, and the period for which you multiply your money. So all of us have understood the formula, but none of us has really understood the power of this. Okay, power of compounding is the greatest mathematical discovery ever made. So all the world's richest men and women, they know only one formula, and which is the power of compounding. The benefit is you're earning interest on interest. As time expands, this becomes a huge snowball.
All right. Harsh, coming to you, how essential is it to leverage the power of compounding as early as possible?
There is this famous fable that what constitutes New York today, Manhattan. Let's take the example of Bombay, for example. But just imagine Bombay 385 years back. The fable was that Manhattan was owned by the Red Indians. And when the Portuguese came in, they bought Manhattan for all of $24, right? That this was way back in 1633. Sounds like a very bad deal, right? Let me give you another input. That $33, if it is invested, say, at 8%, 385 years gone, how much do you think it would be worth today? The number is actually US$177 trillion. That's three times the world's GDP. But let's forget that. I think this illustrates the power of compounding. Why am I using that to say time is very important? Just pick up that same figure of $24. Instead of doing it in 1633, had they done it in 1673, from 385 years, the period came down to 345. Well, the number goes down to 8 trillion. The final number went down by 95%. The earlier you start, the N increases. So in this formula, P into 1 plus R raised to N, Most people focus on R. Very few people focus on N. I think N is the most important focus.
And as Harsh said, the cost of delay. So we all Indians have this very peculiar habit, you know, let's start tomorrow. Kal shuruaat karte hain. Next financial year. We don't like to start today. That cost of delay is so expensive. If I'm asking all of you to put 1 lakh rupees per annum at the age of 25, at 12% return, when you turn 60, you will get 6 crores rupees. Okay? 6 crores. The moment you delay by 1 year, not starting at 25, you're starting at 26. In your retirement, you're not short by 1 lakh, you're now short by 60 lakh rupees, which means to buy that one bike, you have now lost 2 Mercedes cars. The rules of compounding are start early, save as much as you can and invest that money, and try to earn a higher rate of return for a longer time. You will earn a magical figure.
Yeah, so start early and watch your money grow, and that's the tip for you. So Gajendra, what are the factors that investors should keep in mind that power of compounding is actually working rightly for them?
Power of compounding is, it has 3 variables. What is the principle you are putting in? At what rate of return you are putting this money, and for what time period? If you really want to have a gigantic figure, if you really want to create lots of wealth, all these 3 things, principal, your return and time, has to work at the highest levers. If any one of them is working at a lower figure, you won't get the desired results. Many people ask me, can I become rich by putting in fixed deposits? Fixed deposits, you can preserve your money, but you cannot create wealth by putting your money to work at 6-7% because you are hardly able to beat inflation. So these are the factors you need to think when you really want to create a lot of wealth.
So Harsh, is power of compounding always a positive thing, or there are some pitfalls?
Power of compounding is a concept, right? And if you don't understand it well and somebody else does, it can be used as much against you as in your favor. And I'll just give you 2 examples, right? Look at this investment proposition. Please invest 1 lakh rupees every year for the next 30 years. After that, every month, you will get 25,000 rupees till as long as you live, right? And when you die, your family will get 70 lakhs. 1 lakh for 30 years, you invest 30 lakhs. 25,000 every month you will get till as long as you live, right? And when you die, your family gets 70 lakhs. How does this sound? This is power of compounding for you. The return in this, the reason it sounds good is because the N is high, right? You've saved for 30 years. The R in this case is 5%. Where it is negative actually is when you take loans. That time the power of compounding is working against you, right? It's the bank who's getting the power of compounding.
All right, so let's take a very short break. We'll be back on NSC FinWiz Season 5 powered by CNBC TV 18. Welcome back. You're watching NSC FinWiz Season 5 powered by CNBC TV 18. And starting with you, Gajendra. So this time, you know, this is the tax saving season now, and all the employees are rushing towards buying tax saving products which can give them benefits under Section 80C. So what are the things that they should really be looking at this time?
We have a plethora of options under Section 80C. You have, you know, the normal things like your EPF balances, your insurance premiums which you pay, or FDs, or tax saving mutual funds, or even if you have taken home loans, you can claim the principal component. If your children going to school, you can claim tuition expenses. So there are many options, and usually this Section 80C really gets filled pretty fast. So the mistake which we make is normally we buy insurance policies which we treat as investments, and we buy endowment plans, money back, or whole life plans. We pay huge premium, but we are heavily underinsured, and we also don't make as much returns as we could over a longer period of time. So my first piece of advice is, with this benefit, go and first buy yourself a term insurance plan, okay, which is a pure risk protection cover, which is very inexpensive. And the kind of cover you should have is, there is a thumb rule here, whatever is your annual income, at least 10 times of the annual income you should have the cover. So if you have a 10 lakh rupees annual income, you should have a minimum cover of 1 crore. And you can buy a term plan for this. The remaining money, of course, you can use for EPF, which is already been debited from your salary. If at all any money left under Section 80C, you can invest. If you are little, if you can take little higher risk, want higher returns, you can invest in tax saving mutual funds also. Another thing which most of us miss is something called NPS, which is also additional 50,000 rupees you can do. Many of us are not aware of, and that's why we just give it a pass. Under Section 80D, you can do medical insurance, health insurance. You can buy up to 25,000 rupees for yourself, and you can buy additional 30,000 rupees for your parents until this year. From next year onwards, you can actually buy worth 50,000 rupees of medical insurance for your parents as well if they are senior citizens.
Okay, I would also like to highlight one point here, that some of us do have an insurance policy and we think that it is an investment. How to differentiate between insurance and investment?
Keep your insurance requirements separate from investments. Insurance and investments are not one in the thing. It's not good to mix them. Buy a pure term insurance cover. In term insurance cover, whatever premiums you pay, you don't get back anything if nothing happens to you, okay? That's how health insurance or motor insurance are. Anything for investments, you can choose your vehicle depending on your risk profile, your tax situation and other constraints, but don't mix it.
So at this point in time, let's take some audience questions. The first member from our audience is Ruben.
So as we are just started up, so we are just planning big. So I want to buy a house. At the same time, I want to, just in an initial stage, I want to earn for the future things. So what are the requirements that I need to do, and what are the steps that I need to take it from my initial stages onwards?
The amount that he wants to accumulate is 20 lakhs. On a monthly basis, he can save 10,000 rupees. And the time horizon for him is 10 to 15 years. Do you think that's achievable? What to do?
If you just go to Google, there are many of these goal-based calculators, okay, wherein you can write, this is the goal amount you're looking after 20 years. And to achieve this, what is the amount you need to save per month at a given rate of interest? It will give you a figure. Right now, your capacity is 10,000 rupees a month. You should not be disheartened. You should start with whatever you have got. Then every year, try to increase this amount, by whatever percentage you can. So this is a goal tracker. If you have a goal and if you are tracking it, very earnestly, you will be able to reach it. The problem what most of us happen is that we don't know what our goals are. Everybody in the room will definitely say that I want to have a comfortable retirement. But have you really worked out what is that number you're looking at? When you turn 60, how much do you really require as a retirement corpus? And then you have to work backwards to start saving. Once you've got these numbers, stick to these numbers and make sure that you maintain the discipline.
Harsh, if you could also explain to us
about retirement. Retirement is for old people, right? So the point is, how do you estimate what you will need for retirement? I think a good way to start is always, if I was to retire today, how much would I need? You look at whatever expenses you have, you eliminate those that are not going to be there when you retire. Add things, you will have more medical expenditure that may not always be covered by insurance. You will have more social expenditure. Add plus minus, you arrive at today's, if you were to retire today, what would be the expenditure? After that, you can use the calculators to check how much money you would need.
Our next audience member is Anumeha Sharma.
Question to you is, like, we know the power of compounding, but when we invest in share markets, there is like market turbulence which also affects the risks that we take. So how does compounding commensurate with the risk that are created due to the market turbulence?
Do your research well. Buy the companies as if you own the business. We are sitting in Dr. Reddy's campus. Yeah. Dr. Reddy's is also listed,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So if you're just buying Dr. Reddy's for today and tomorrow, you won't make money. But if you're buying it like a proper businessman and hold it for 10, 20 years, I think you'll create tons of. So ignore the short-term noise. And each company goes through good times and bad times, yeah. So you have to live with it. Volatility is a part of this animal. Yeah. But if you live and if you can have patience and discipline, you are going to make a lot of money.
Well, patience is the key to high returns here, right? Okay, so hope that answers your question.
Yeah.
All right. Our next question is from Suresh Kumar.
So my dream is to retire with more than 5 crore in bank balance. And I'm planning to investment close to 25 to 30,000 per month for coming 15 years.
It may seem very well today that 5 crore is good enough for your retirement, but that may not be the case. What we are not taking here is the rate of inflation, what kind of lifestyle you have. So you need to be very realistic with these goals. And keep looking at these numbers every year so that you are more or less in line with what you wanted to do.
Well, on that note, we'll take a very short break and we'll be back on NSC FinWiz Season 5 powered by CNBC TV 18. back. You're watching NEC FinWiz Season 5 powered by CNBC TV 18. And today we are here at Dr. Reddy's Laboratories at their Vizag campus. And now let's open the floor to our audience.
In my case, I have invested 1 lakh rupees. Every day I'm still investing. This ULIP policy, United Linked Insurance Policy, where the returns and the life risk also has been captured. So as you said that you have to differentiate these two, where whenever you are going to for risk factors, you have to go life insurance only. Don't mix the investment policies in this. So I just wanted to understand if both are covered in these policies, so what is the real disadvantage?
ULIP is a combination of both insurance and investment. The problem with ULIPs earlier was that because of high charges in the ULIPs, a lot of portion of your returns would be eaten away by these charges in the initial years. And that's why you would never get the benefit of power of compounding. You'll have to look at the policy conditions again because you've just invested for 3 years. Look at what are the charges you are paying. If the charges are more than 2-2.5-3% per annum, you would be better off investing in mutual funds. So I think the best thing is for you to just go and see the terms and conditions, look at the charges. If the charges are higher, don't pay any further premiums. And after 2 years, when the exit period is over, take the money out and invest in maybe a mutual fund.
All right, we hope you've answered your question. Okay. Next audience.
Is it really beneficial to invest in a real estate rather than in like mutual funds or any other, like one of my colleagues said, ULIP or anything?
No matter what your view is in real estate or what my view is on equity or debt or anything like that, one thing is absolutely certain. It never pays to put all your eggs in one single basket. Think long and hard whether you want to bet your entire retired life, not just yours, your spouse's, entire retired life on one single asset class. That's one. Now let me come to real estate as an asset class by itself. I think there is nothing wrong with either real estate or equity or fixed deposit. It depends on your needs and on your beliefs as well. It needs to be moderated. How much would I recommend for a client? I think for a client with a very large portfolio, I think real estate being more than 20-25% of your portfolio does not make sense. It is a very, very involved asset class. It's not a fill it, shut it, forget it asset class like equity or debt.
Last question from our audience.
Many things whatever you discuss look like foreign language for me. Because of the reason I don't spend much investment. So I was just thinking is that income, whatever I get it, is there any specific number which will be given to say that this much percentage of savings, if you do that, that is a good. Is there any number we can able to save from the expert? I try to hear it from you.
Just make you start today. If you really have to do this in a very systematic manner, it may take you another year. We always say the way normally, how do we invest? So what happens, we earn, we spend and we save. This is what normal people do. Right? Our earning is limited. Our expenses have no controls. We don't know how much we are going to spend in this month, how much we are going to spend next month. There is always a question mark. If there is a question mark on spending, then there is always a question mark on savings. Because income minus expenses is savings. You will never be able to maintain discipline. The day you change this equation to income minus saving and whatever remain in the bank account is spending, the ideal thumb rule can be anywhere in the range of 20-30% to begin with. And keep increasing this every year as your salary increases, as your income increases, as our expenses increase, why not our savings be? And that is where something called a step-up SIP. SIP in mutual fund is the best way for a salaried people to become more disciplined. A fixed month, a systematic investment plan, a fixed month goes from your bank account on first of the month or second or fifth and invested. You have no control. So every year, automatically your SIP will increase. So do that, and somewhere along the line, make sure that you get out time to make out these goals and then just try to link the two. You will have a much better answer.
Well, on that note, we are completely timed out on this week's episode of NSC FinWiz Season 5 powered by CNBC TV 18. We really hope we have managed to clear all your financial doubts through our panel of experts here. So see you again next week as we continue our NSC FinWiz journey, and thanks for watching.
We don't have that much of time to spend on the financial aspects in the organization. So the entire program is given such a beautiful view on how to invest on day-to-day life.
What are the things we need to plan and how to be a peaceful life after retirement. So that is the thing which I learned it, and now I need to change the plan of the investment, which where right investment I have to do it.
It's very good and it is very interesting actually, and it is very helpful to us and it is very useful. And I suggest my friends to take this type of a challenge. And just as of now, the present situation, I'm earning for what I'm earning. So I'm saving for 25%. So my next target has to double for that.